Anthony Dillon, academic and Aboriginal Affairs commentator, and lastly, Jacinta Price, who is an Alice Springs town councillor and commentator on Aboriginal issues. So we'll start with Corinne.
Because I know that I'm writing from a place of honesty and a place of truth. I've got got better things to do than to try to convince them that I'm right. I know I'm right, so let them get on with it. Corin, in the fact that I'm also what you'd call a recovering feminist. I call myself a feminist until probably the middle of 2016 when I started YouTubing Miley Yiannopoulos and realized I was wrong about everything and he was right about everything. But I never called myself a feminist because I felt particularly discriminated against. I mean, I'm not. I did it because I was always a conservative and I believed in freedom and individualism and, you know, women being able to do, say, and think whatever they want, which are libertarian conservative values, not collectivist groupthink values. But feminism got hijacked by social justice warriors and feminazis over the last 10 years, and it's turned into something else. And when I started, you know, publicly coming out and going on television and doing this kind of right-wing, sometimes counter-feminist commentary, I noticed a distinct trend in the types of criticism I received and the types of people that I received it from. And I get billed as this kind of anti-feminist writer, anti-feminist commentator. That's not true. My first and foremost concern was freedom of speech and anti-political correctness. The only reason I turned to this kind of counter-feminist thing is because they were the ones who leveled the most horrific criticism at me, similarly to Corin. And I spoke about it earlier today, but when this, again, Clementine was the cause of a lot of this. Dee Madigan was another. There are a few of them, but certainly Clementine set all of, she did exactly the same thing. She made horrible comments and told lies and set her, you know, 100,000 or so followers on me for probably, wasn't as bad as yours, about 30 hours. 30 hours mine went for, and then there was another one a couple of months later. But what I realized about these social justice warriors and feminazis is that their protections are exclusive to people who agree with them. So if you are a woman who disagrees with feminists, then all of the protections of anti-sexism and anti-misogyny and all of that kind of stuff, they don't apply to you because you deserve to be punished for stepping out of the pack, which renders their whole, this whole social justice narrative, it doesn't just apply to women, it applies to Aboriginals, to trans people, to LGBT people, anyone who is in a perceived identity group who doesn't conform to what they think that identity group should believe in, gets ostracized and demonized and vilified. So really, What I realized, and it was a big light bulb, that their concern is not protecting the vulnerable, it's exerting control. They want to control the masses, and they do this because they live purposeless existences. They're usually not too bright either. And that's their way of finding their way in the world, is by finding a pack, roping people in, and getting and being horrible to people who won't conform because they're so terrified of being proven wrong. And deep down, they know they're wrong. And that's what frightens them the most. Because if you rip that carpet out from underneath them, they have nothing. Absolutely nothing, which is why they exude the level of vitriol and malice and violence and everything else that they propagate. So as Corin said, you know, they used to affect me horribly. At the beginning of the year, I will admit that they really affected me terribly. But as Corin said, I know I'm right. I know I'm right at the end of the day. And so why would you bother? Why would you bother? Really, really the key is, and sometimes I get inflammatory on social media, but I remember, no, just ignore them, because what they want is attention. Don't give them attention. don't give them the satisfaction that you've even contemplated what they're doing and thinking, because they want to humiliate you into silence. Just don't let them do it.
Okay, good afternoon. Being on stage with these four lovely ladies, I'm thinking, how lucky can one guy get? Okay, look at them. So I'm going to give an Indigenous perspective spin. So about social media debate and our message. And so a bit of what I say goes with Jacinta. Debates and that, we know you really can't win. As Gabrielle pointed out in his presentation, you can't win against the idiots. They'll pull you down to their level and they'll beat you with experience. And so we know that. So you think, well, why do we do it? There are some very important implications that I want to talk about. So it's not just about winning the debate. A couple of things. First of all, we are in the age of social media. So you've got to use it. You've got to respond to it. You've got to get your message out. So I'd say there's no getting away from it. But it has become an opportunity or a platform for, within Indigenous politics, for Indigenous people to inflict on other Indigenous people the most shocking, vilest hate imaginable against other Indigenous people, which is far worse than what Jacinta, myself, Warren, Marcia, all the others have ever received from white people. And that goes unnoticed in society. Because again, there's this propaganda push that racism is the evil culprit that's pushing down on Indigenous people. It's not. The myth of, I'm not saying racism doesn't exist, but it's greatly exaggerated. That's not the big problem. The big problem are the things we've spoken about before: violence, high incarceration rates, unemployment, that sort of thing. The amount of hate is just shocking, and it just pulls the Indigenous advancement back. Okay, we cannot move forward when there's all this hate. Something more serious. We go to social media because we've got messages we want to get out there, important messages that we think will make a difference in the lives of Indigenous Australians. And when you are criticised and demonised and seen as a sellout by your own people, that means that very often the message that you so badly want to get out there to the people who need it most will reject it simply because you have been portrayed as, you know, the sellout, the devil. So I say this with Cindy and myself, the insults, that means nothing to us. It means absolutely nothing. It's the fact that it really destroys our message from having its full effect out there. And it's no exaggeration to say too, like, I'm safe. The worst that happens to me is I get slandered, my message has no effect because I've been branded as this sellout Aboriginal person. But I write from behind my desk. I'm just a commentator. I put my ideas out there. Someone like Jacinta is visiting people in remote communities. If those people have been informed beforehand that Jacinta is this evil traitor, that she's here to take Aboriginal children away from her, there can be really serious consequences, such as death, if she goes into a community, and what the people there know about her is, you know, that she's this evil black person, white on the inside, or whatever. So it is serious stuff. Yes, social media can be a good tool for doing good things, but it has become, it's fallen into the wrong hands. And what the solution to that is, I'm not sure. Certainly having conferences like this is a big help. But we got a lot to contend with, so thank you. And I should just add, with all the shit we cop, having support from people like you makes a huge difference. It keeps us doing what we do.
Myself injury. Might as well get to the mic. I'll
short and sweet so that we can sort of have more questions. I know that my session before, I ended exactly right on time, and I think there are some disappointed people in the audience who want to ask questions. But anyway, I'll just want to begin with, I guess, the challenges as an Aboriginal woman I face in trying to address the very serious issues of family violence, and the fact that, you know, the most marginalised people are Aboriginal women and children. You know, the fact that our men, 75% of Aboriginal men incarcerated are incarcerated for crimes of violence against their own loved ones. And I've been told that I demonise Aboriginal men, and how dare I, and, you know, poor bugger these Aboriginal men that I keep demonising, despite the fact that women are being buried constantly. And some of my biggest opponents online are, in fact, white female feminists. Well, female feminists, yeah. and so, you know, it's quite contradictory that, you know, they supposedly champion the rights of Aboriginal people and stand up and defend us, you know, against racism. And I always point out that racism is not killing us. It is family violence that is killing us. And that, yes, racism does exist. However, it's a mental illness that belongs to a racist. It's not our problem. We should stop giving it as much attention as we are. And in my experience growing up, my you know, in the Northern Territory, I've always believed that we just, you know, we do things quite well. We just, this thing called reconciliation or reconciliation or whatever you want to call it, we just do it. We just live it. We get on with it. You know, we marry one another, and, you know, we forge our paths through driving each other crazy. Well, I'm just speaking about my parents' experience, because they probably drove me crazy over the years. coming from having a traditional Aboriginal Warrawari mother and a white Australian father. But we just get on with it, and we move forward, and we know how to love one another, and we do that quite well. So, yeah, so these Western white feminists are those who attempt, so, you know, are just falling over themselves online to try and bring me down. You know, recently I've had a number of complaints made to the CEO of Alice Springs Town Council, because I've spoken out against a prominent crime family, the Vollers, in Central Australia. I've been had my life threatened by Joanne Voller. I've known Dylan since he was a kid. He slept in my household as a kid. And there are things I know about him which are quite concerning, but because of laws, we can't speak about the sorts of crimes that he's committed. So I have had complaints made against me, and of course, my good people of Alice Springs voted me back in on the second term with a landslide number of votes, because they know that I don't muck around, I get straight to the point, and I'm no nonsense, and I'll tell it how it is. And this is how it is. So a good CEO just said to me, look, Jacinta, we've got a few complaints about you, and look, I know you're copying it from all over the place, and all I'm going to do is just say, look, she's well within her means to address issues that are outside of council matters as an individual, but I'll remind her of her responsibilities, so I'll be bummed to all those. We try to bring me down. So what's difficult for Aboriginal women is the fact that not only have we got these mad feminazis, and I'm a mother of four sons, by the way, and they don't like feminazis either, but we're dealing with them, but we're also dealing with, you know, as Mike Latham was talking about earlier in his talk, was that when it comes to being able to take steps of enlightenment, for Aboriginal people, we're not allowed to. We're supposed to remain stagnant. We're supposed to be museum pieces and maintain our culture and our language. And everyone's got this idea that out in the bush we, you know, hover above the earth as these spiritual beings, when we're just human beings, just like everybody else. So what we've got is this notion, but we've also got Aboriginal society is extremely patriarchal. If you want to talk about misogynists, Well, we can give you prime examples of what's going on right under our noses in our very own country about the way that women are treated in Aboriginal society, in Aboriginal culture, and how it traditionally has panned out over the years. So we should be allowed to evolve like the rest of humanity, and we need to, in fact, have our own feminist movement, real feminist movement, not feminazi movement, but a feminist movement that recognises Aboriginal women as equal to Aboriginal men in our own culture and our own society. So what we've had is, you know, 3 or 4 decades ago, when everyone was fighting for the rights of Aboriginal people in our country, Aboriginal women stood by our Aboriginal men because, you know, the fight was against racism. But that has continued, and it's become very detrimental when we're trying to stamp out family violence and those sorts of issues. So we've still got this sort of underlying, you know, thing going on where women feel like we have to stick together as Aboriginal people against, you know, oppression, racism, all those sorts of things, instead of going, you know what, the violence has to stop. Our women have to stop dying. Our children have to stop being abused. We have to lift the standard for our people. That's not happening fast enough for Aboriginal women. So we're faced with that, as well as being faced with now these preenies that are trying to take over Alice Springs and the Northern Territory, who know better than us, who are the most paternalistic individuals you will come across. And that is the fight that we're up against. But again, as Anthony said, having the opportunity to address people like yourselves is wonderful, because it's about, you know, education for everyone. It's really of utmost importance for Aboriginal people out in remote communities, for young women and girls, but also for the general population of Australia who don't really know what's going on in remote parts of Australia, who actually, you know, want to contribute to moving forward for Aboriginal people. And just understand that we're just human beings, just like everybody else, and let's lift the bar and not expect to just stay down here because poor Aboriginal people aren't capable of lifting ourselves up. That's what's keeping us down.
So, question for Anthony and Jacinta. I'm just wondering, should we be calling out the critics that you've spoken about, that they betray a really ugly mentality? I'm wondering, should we call them out for what they are, that they are the true racists peddling the myth that Aboriginals can't make their own decisions, and that Aboriginal affairs is serious white fella stuff that should be taken care of by white fellas? Should we be calling them out on that?
Okay, first of all, Aboriginal affairs is everyone's business, so whites and blacks equally should have a say in Aboriginal affairs because we're Australian. But yes, calling them out, and that just lets them know, hey, that their voices, their nasty voices, aren't the only voices, that there's a large majority out there that are backing us. So, yes, do it.
Aboriginal like spirituality, that sort of stuff, it seems like you're sort of saying that's not as important. Like, do you think that they shouldn't focus on that, or it should it just be a thing that is a choice that you can sort of, like, should we really keep the sort of focus on Aboriginal people being moved through like white society just the same as white people, or should, with the option to always go back and practice their spirituality?
So what needs to happen is Aboriginal people need to be able to evolve like the rest. rest of humanity. And in that sense, we need to take those parts of our culture and our spirituality that work for us, that work positively for us in a modern context. But we also need to adopt the tools of the modern world in order to survive. You know, it's a different kind of survival in this day and age, and that's what we need to do. We need to take the good from the traditional ways and make it work in a modern context, but also understand the modern world in order to move forward and survive. Look, when it comes to spirituality, all of Aboriginal society was underpinned through spirituality. Understanding your Jumburba and your tie to your country and your land was all that. When you knew about your country, you knew how to survive in it. But see, Aboriginal people aren't living off the land anymore. So hence why, the Jumburba, the spiritual side of things, is sort of falling away. But and increasingly, a lot more Aboriginal people are turning to Christianity as well. And, there's, in Central Australia, there's the influence of missionaries. During the frontier, a lot of missionaries actually protected Aboriginal people. And a lot of people, Aboriginal people put Christianity as another spiritual layer on top of what they already knew. So they never actually replaced it. But I think it's, again, we're in a global world now, and it's down to the individual on how they, want to conduct themselves. But like I said, the positive stuff from the old ways with the modern ways as well.
G'day guys. I was just wondering, to what degree might you be able to all speak about some of the issues that you're facing, the victim narratives and the abuse and conformity having a relationship to the fact that neo-Marxism and postmodernism is being taught in gender studies and post-colonial studies and that are really enforcing and legitimizing these narratives in the mainstream. Thank you.
Just on that, I wrote a piece fairly recently, and it's become my line that I'll trot out in answer to any of those kind of issues. Violence is never acceptable despite your cause, and they seem to be words that work, and they apply absolutely across the board to absolutely everything. I'm not interested in getting into any debate past that point. Violence is not acceptable despite your cause. I think we can all agree there's a distinct neo-Marxist agenda being pushed in universities. And I think we can also agree definitely that it's being pushed in high schools and there's a push to push it even more. I think in terms of that relating to the victim mentality of, say, millennials, I think a lot of millennials specifically, so people who are sort of born from, well, the later millennials, sort of, people born sort of 1990 onwards, a lot of them are a lost cause, sadly. There are a few, particularly on the older side, like people sort of in their late 20s, early 30s, who have seen the light, but a lot of the younger ones are completely ruined. But that's okay, because given that agenda push in high schools, if you look at Generation Z, for instance, who are born after the year 2000, there was a study in England by a Martin firm called The Guild, I believe, that found that Generation Z is projected to be the most conservative generation since the Second World War. Yes. Very good. And the reason for that is that natural instinct of teenagers is to rebel. So no matter what you teach them or tell them to do, they'll do the opposite, because it's a young people sort of push for independence. So you could argue, and people do and I do, that this huge sort of gender studies push in high schools, and certainly teaching young white teenage boys to hate themselves for being born with the original sin of being white and male, is having an opposite effect. And there was a very interesting incident with Clement. Again, Clement, gosh, she sucks a lot of oxygen, Clementine. But she's a good example. She went on about a 2030 tweet rant a few months ago, because she gave a talk at Aquinas College in Melbourne on gender and sexism in the media and in the entertainment industry, and the kids weren't buying it. And she kept going on about how all these 15-year-old boys had come at her with, remember that, with questions about the pay gap, and they were, you know, Googling Milo probably and finding, you know, oh, it doesn't exist, blah, 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 blah. But what she didn't let on, and I trawled through this stuff, of course, because I was fascinated, that the girls weren't buying it either. And a lot of the students, both boys and girls, had heard she was trashing them on Twitter, and so created Twitter accounts specifically to trash her back. But there were three or four girls tweeting us saying, no, it wasn't just the boys, it was us as well. We don't like what you were saying because we felt you were blaming the boys, and all the boys we know are lovely, and we don't know what you're talking about, and that was the problem our year group had with you. Brilliant. So that's what she was most triggered about. It wasn't the fact that the boys were disagreeing with her, because she can fob them off as arrogant or misogynistic, but it was the girls. The girls weren't buying it, and that's what frightens them. So I think if there's a push for neo-Marxism and sort of gender in high schools, let's keep pushing it. Because it's obviously pushing them literally in the right direction.
I have one here. For better or worse, you know, I've lived in Australia for quite a while, and I noticed that it tends to copy things that happen in the US, for better or worse. And is one of the things they're copying is the race hustling industry that you see in America, the Black Lives Matter, all that sort of stuff. And if so, are you guys looking to people like Thomas Sowell to see how you counter that?
You're quite correct. Yes, we do kind of copy America. We have the Black Lives movement over here, and like over there, it seems that Black Lives, the only Black Lives that matter are those ones where you can implicate a white in the death of a black person. The reality is blacks are far more likely to be killed by other blacks, many times the rate that they're killed by, you know, that whites are killing whites or killing blacks. And so yeah, that's definitely happening here. And I take my power off to people like Sal and you know, Larry Elder and similar ones in America.
Sheriff Clark.
Yeah, and there's one fellow I'm trying to, not Shelby Steele. Yeah, but we got people like that here as well. Unfortunately, the voices are often drowned out by those with the loudest voices, and the loudest voices are those who know where their next meal is coming from. They don't go to bed at night fearing that they will be bashed or raped. It's those other quieter, silent voices that we need to listen to. And Jacinta brings a voice.
Hello, this is a question for Jacinta and Dylan. I just wonder if you know about the original nation's passport. And if you do, how do you think it's connected to the No Borders movement? And what would Aboriginal people think of the original nation's passport?
So that's another passport for Indigenous people?
It is. It actually is different from the Aboriginal passport, which allows international travel. The original nation's passport is actually for travel within Australia across all the different Aboriginal lands and countries. And activists, I think, in the socialist movement have been handing it out to asylum seekers, saying that the Australian government doesn't have any right to say who can enter Australia. It's Aboriginal people who've got that right, and they symbolically hand them this original nation's passport to allow them travel within Australia.
No, I haven't heard of that one, but I would be pretty sure those ones who are pushing it the most Probably look about as Aboriginal as what you do.
Do we have any more questions?
Yes.
I'm not going to comment on that because this bit of...
Question's more for the entire panel, or perhaps Green and Daisy. Some of us have had a road to Damascus moment. We've had an epiphany, we've seen the light, as you have. And trying to have conversations with other people who have not yet gone on that journey. I just wanted to ask if you would like to comment on any conversations you've had with former friends or peers or people, and have you had any progress towards getting them more to think about these issues and maybe towards a more logical conclusion?
That's a really good question. I think the red pill has actually opened a lot of eyes in this country and around the world, and it's also a really good reference point rather than starting to scrap online. Just asking, have you seen it? Please can you watch it? That's saved me hours over the last few months. But also, I would like to think, over the last year, I would say even on my Facebook page, which I've only had one in a year, there's been a big shift in Invisible Awakening, and it's trickling down. It's mothers who see their sons in trouble. It's grandmothers who see their grandsons in trouble. It's siblings who see marriages break down and their brothers drowning, just, you know, not being able to afford anything. It's child support. There are recurring themes that are bonding people, and it's like a flow effect, and it's trickling down, I would say. And I would say the amount of support that I've had, much as the haters have gone through the roof, there's also been a rise in support too, and for women, which is really, really heartening to see.
I think it depends on the person that you're talking to, and it also depends on how much you value the friendship, whether or not you want to go ahead with the conversation. I've had many conversations with friends, some of whom are no longer friends for obvious reasons, about my beliefs and my ideology and contrasting to theirs. There are times when I've thought they've gone so red, I thought their heads would explode, because they were so bizarrely angered by me presenting something that wasn't the mainstream opinion. And that's when you have to go, okay, look, I've been friends with you since we were 10, this is not worth that. That gets very tedious after a while, because if you're constantly worried about expressing your opinion because you don't want to hurt someone's feelings and you're sure they might not want to be friends with you anymore, well, they're probably not that good of a friend anyway. But then I've also had friends, women actually, more so than men, come to me and say, one very recently, she said to me, look, Daisy, you're a writer, you're into all this political stuff. I've got some questions. And she was a lefty. She said, look, I'm being told this by feminists. I don't buy it. I don't buy this weird kind of victim thing. Can you help me? So she actually asked me for friends. So I sat her down and I talked her through some stuff, showed her a few YouTube videos of, you know, Ben Shapiro and Milo and people like that. And she was relieved, and she said, my God, thank you. She was totally red-pilled in the space of about half an hour, and she just said, thank you so much. I was so confused, and all this stuff people are telling me I don't get. So I think it depends on the person. But I do agree with you. I think there is a groundswell amongst women, especially, who are being given a view of the world by a lot of miserable people that they don't recognize. So I think, yeah, there's a groundswell, definitely.
Yeah, and I have to agree that there is a groundswell occurring. I know that every time Australia Day comes around and I post a post about why I love this country so much and why I support Australia Day, my Facebook page starts hitting likes like there's no tomorrow. and yeah, it's usually the very controversial issues that I speak on that gets me the most likes and also the most attention from the haters. But in my experience, what I'm seeing is that despite the fact that people come at me with their dislike and their the fact that they feel very insecure about themselves and project that onto me, is that there are an incredible amount of Australians who are just sick to death of the crap. That, you know, there's so much goodwill in this country for Aboriginal people and Aboriginal issues, and there are those who have just absolutely milked it, and, you know, I think the goodwill is going to run dry fairly soon. And what we're seeing now is people who are going, hang on a second, you know, I've I've done my part, I think, you know, and I'm not going to become one of these virtue signalers. I know what I've done, and I know what I've contributed, and I'm sick of being told I'm a racist or, you know, grumpy old white men. You guys are, you're amongst the minority these days, aren't you? Like, I was recently coming into the election for the Alice Springs Town Council. The local online rag decided to interview me, and they, Kieran Flynn asked me, she said to me, Jacinta, why is it that, and she looked very puzzled, she said, why an Aboriginal woman like yourself, did you, you know, in the previous council, there are a lot of conservative white men, why did you, you know, you seem to agree with a lot of what they said, and I looked at her puzzled, and it was like it was strange that an Aboriginal woman should agree with a white conservative male, and I looked at her and I said, my dad's a grumpy old white man, like, and I'm a daddy's girl. Like, of course I feel, you know, like a connection with grumpy old white men. But I just, you know, I'm married to one too. And he's Scottish. I swear this a lot. I thought, how ridiculous. Like, why is there this constant look to divide? But even as we go further along with this constant sort of push for this division, I'm seeing more and more this groundswell of, no, let's be unified, let's stand together. You know, bloody hell, we're all human beings, first and foremost, before anything. And so there's this incredible outpour of support that goes on as well online for me, as much as there is, you know, the dislike. And, I mean, the good thing is, I do have lefty mates. I have plenty of lefty mates who agree with a lot of what I say. And we can also agree or disagree on some issues as well. And I am getting, Indigenous people from different parts of the country who are, instead of attacking me, they're going, I'm confused by what you're trying to say. Can we talk? And, yeah, absolutely. I'll even sit online and have it out with someone who obviously needs an education. He's just completely got things wrong because the media is portrayed in a particular way, or this particular stupid, you know, Aboriginal rights Facebook page have portrayed me as something ridiculous. And I'll argue with them, and then they'll turn around and say, oh, well, I didn't realise that, you know, that was going on, but thank you for informing me. And it's just about this information. I mean, the last time I caught up with Warren Mundine, he himself and my mother, we said, let's have a photo put on social media and see what comes out of this. So, you know, I was doing that like this. And, you know, this is, you know, catching up with great friends and plotting was his, what he'd written underneath. And sure enough, they got hold of it. The haters got hold of it. And they said, oh, here's Warren Mundine, Jacinta Price, Best Price, just hours after, you know, demonstrators were arrested with police brutality, you know, demonstrating against, you know, protesting against youth detention centres, and here we are laughing at it and plotting our next. I was even told that I was showing the Masonic symbol and a picture next to Donald Trump, for crying out loud. Don't these idiots know you've got to be a bloke to be a Mason? I mean, you know.